Welcome to the Bob Sullivan Show. And with your host, it's Bob Sullivan.
Thank you for joining me for another edition of the Bob Sullivan Show. Today I have on with me the lovely Becky Schaller of the Body by Becky. How are you doing today, Becky?
I'm fantastic. How are you, Bob?
I'm doing great. Now, if there's a gay guy standing on the street corner, how much is it going to affect whether somebody grows up? Like, is that going to make them gay? Probably not. If they see a gay guy standing on the corner going, "Hi, how are you?" No. It's their stupid kid. Explain it. I don't care.
I think if you have that mentality, is good. I love, like, people always ask if I want to move where I am. No, I love where I live because I'm in the middle. I feel, like, of such a community that I feel very safe. I will walk to the gym at this hour and go to the gym, and I will be surrounded by inspiring, super, like, attractive men, and none of them will hit on me because they're all gay. But it's, like, you know, it's different. Like, I love that part of it. I love also just accepting their culture. Like, they're cool about it, you know, and they don't think that I'm gay. They don't think anything. They just know that it's just, I like to be living in different situations, and I feel comfortable here. I don't think I could live safely in a city this big in any other place and be right in the middle of it and feel as comfortable as I do. Because I don't know, it's just a very cool place to live, I guess.
Well,
and they got the nightclubs and the best dancing. And I can go out and there's no line sometimes for the girls' bathroom, which never happens.
Well,
I'm just saying.
Do you have a, like, how often when you go to clubs are you the first one to be let in?
You know, and that's again,
like, are you the hot chick that walks up and the guy's like, "Oh yeah, you're on the list," but there's no list and you're just hot?
Yeah. Right. The only time it's been really noticeable that I wasn't on the list, because a lot, so it's the other thing too, like, I'll go out and I'll just, like, walk up, and I don't like that, if you're not on the list, you can't come in kind of thing. I just think it's so silly sometimes, so sometimes I do it on purpose. I act like I have no idea, but one time, I did a shot to Mermont, and I went, and I was just like, "Yeah, I'm on the list," but the guy was like, "You know, it's a private party," and I was like, "Yeah." And he was like, "Are you sure?" And I'm like, "Yeah." And it was after the MTV Awards. I went in, and I was with my other girlfriend. But we looked around, and it's because there's a person there. I had a great time. But it was clear that it wasn't, like, on the list. That was the first time. But I just now realized, when someone asked me that question the other day, like, "How'd you get in?" I was like, "I always get in, don't you?" And they're like, "No, Becky." So yeah, I guess there are some benefits to some things.
What do you flaunt when you're trying to get into these clubs to try to really make it a mistake if the bouncer doesn't let you in?
Oh, if he doesn't let me in, what do I do?
Yeah. You throw a hissy fit?
Oh. I think, nothing. Nothing. I just walk, like, maybe I might say something like, "If that's happened, it's happened the last time," and I was just like, "Really?" And then I just left, because I act like they're, and then I'll go again, and I'll go in, and eventually, and then I'll hold this, it'll just, like, I don't argue about anything. I don't.
What? Why not?
I know, right? Well, in that situation, I just think it's silly. And it was because, also, sometimes the bouncers, there's a girl involved, too.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's just guys, that's easy. That's easy. But if there's a girl at all, then it's really different, because girls are not very nice a lot of the times.
How many transvestites have you run into while you're walking to... walk into the club or walk into the to the gym?
Some of them are really like beautiful. So it's hard to tell.
You see,
I look at their feet.
So if their feet are beautiful, you can't tell.
If I ever have a question, I check their feet out. Unless, I'm going to be honest, because Asians are petite, and sometimes the guys, like, and if they've, like, are transvestites, their feet might still really be small. But if it's just a right, like, white or, you know, just a normal, like, white or black, they think it's a transvestite, look at their feet. And if they're big feet, then you know.
You know it's a guy?
Yeah. I mean, there's some things that, it's cool, and whatever, but you just know. But they're beautiful. Sometimes you're like, damn. And they're like, I see your feet. I see what you're doing with your feet. And a lot of times they can't wear really, really high heels. So it'll just be like, I see your 2 inches stilettos. Mm-mm. So you figure things out.
Well, like, I had this idea for a, it never got picked up. It was an idea for a, reality show. It was called that TV show called Next with it was called Trext, and it was with transvestites, and the guy doesn't find out that it's a transvestite until the end, and that's when he has to decide, does he want to go on a second date with this chick or...
Oh my gosh, are you serious?
Yeah, well, I pitched it to MTV and they said no.
But that would be crazy, because I bet someone, that would be crazy.
Well, you have to either accept the, and it's all pre-surgery, so you can have them after the surgery is done. So, you know.
You can have them after the surgery is done. Some people are born in the wrong body. I'm starting to believe more and more about this kind of thing. I really am.
Well, have you noticed that, like, Yeah, I agree with that, too. I think that, I mean, I'm not saying that, like, I know from experience, because I have a fairly, I'm fairly confident that I am a man in a man's body, but I would say that, I mean, like, Chaz Bono, for example.
Yeah.
You know, what a tragedy. But, I mean, look at that. Like, that was a decent, that was a good looking, that was going to be a good-looking girl. And, obviously, she wasn't happy. She obviously had some other issues that don't need to be talked about. But, I mean, she was... She could have been, I mean, your average, average chick in Hollywood. But she wasn't happy. And instead of going down the, you know, the normal route of just being unhappy and going to cocaine, which she may have done anyway, but, like, what's wrong with her changing herself for maybe the better, you know? Like, what's wrong with that? Like, what's wrong with that lifestyle?
Nothing. And that she, I mean, and it's just hard for, well, we only know her story because, you know, it's publicized so much, but imagine anybody that has to come up, do that decision, no matter how small the society or community they grow up in, that it would be a challenging, not accept it a lot of the time. Yeah, I don't see a problem with it. I'm happy that, she was able to do that. But I imagine that's got to be probably one of the hardest things to do with. And you can just tell, like, I mean, it's like she was born in the wrong body, and I feel that if anyone's to criticize her in any kind of way, or... I don't think anything's wrong with it.
Well,
if anything, sympathize and empathize for her situation.
Well, and
to be honest,
it's almost like people would rather her go down the route of cocaine and drugs and alcohol than be happy with making the choice to be a he, I guess. And
yeah.
I mean,
well, it's LA, like, and everyone, like, if it's drugs and alcohol and that kind of thing, it's almost like they just say, and her mom, since her mom was who her mom was, it's just like, oh, that's rock and roll, like, that's LA, like, that's what's supposed to happen, like, that's what you do. So it's almost, like, it's okay if you do that out here.
Well,
if that makes sense.
Well, she almost kind of has started to look like Doug Heffernan a little bit.
Like what?
She kind of looks like Doug Heffernan now.
I was making pictures recently.
Well, I'll have to cut that out then. I mean, yeah, that's a horrible thing to say. I apologize, God. But,
don't cut it out. I just haven't seen it. It's a bad thing to say. I'm so bad. I haven't looked at her pictures. I'll have to, though.
No, I wouldn't say that it's a bad... I mean, she doesn't look like... It's nothing bad. I mean, Well, I guess it is kind of bad to say that a chick that had a sex change looks like Doug Heffernan now, but, I mean, it is true. I mean, here.
Well, maybe she had a bad doc. I mean, because it's not any on top. They have a bad surgeon or a bad doc. Like, you know, like, partly her fault.
Well, would you ever do plastic surgery?
Would I ever do plastic surgery?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You would?
Yeah.
Well, like, where do you draw the line? Like,
I mean, I say that because I imagine in situations like when, I don't know, I wouldn't do anything that would change what, I don't know, I say that because if that happens one day, I never say never, I guess. And I have clients and things that have had things done, and I know it's made them happier. So I see the upside of it, I guess, that maybe other people haven't seen. But then I've also seen some really bad plastic surgery jobs, so if I were ever to do anything, I wouldn't go to, like, some third world country and get a deal, because you hear all that crazy stuff, and I've also seen some really bad things happen from it. It would be a very thought out and, you know, strategic process.
Well, let me ask you this. As a person who works out and, like, does all the, like, lingerie football and, like, how tough is it for a woman with double D's to work out?
Like, well, that's the other thing, too, because I'm into fitness, but I don't ever want to look artificial. And so sometimes I see these fitness models or girls that it really looks like two rocks on, like, it just doesn't even look like boobs or breasts.
Right.
It looks like just these lumps. I wouldn't want that. Then I also see females that definitely probably have sizes, and I've worked with clients that have had three boob jobs, and by the third boob job, like, she has back problems, she couldn't come to sessions because she couldn't get out of bed because it hurts so bad. Like, I've seen the very worst of situations, and I don't like the artificial look.
Oh, no.
So, I don't think that that's beneficial if you're going to go so extreme, but I have seen girls get things done that were within reason, and it made them happier. I don't think you should get anything that's not proportioned to your body.
Oh, bingo. Bingo. Amen. I mean,
yeah.
I went to, my sister, when she graduated from college, like, it would have been 5 years ago, her roommate, who was pretty hot, her mom was like, or her stepmom, pardon me, was a former Miss Oklahoma, and she had a boob job done, but she looked like they were so big that it looked like she was going to tip over. And what happened to the days of, I mean, in order for women to get, I mean, women either used to go the route of, okay, I'm gonna like you, like you're gonna go the fit route, and it's gonna be sexy as hell. And then there's also the route of, okay, I'm gonna eat bad food, I'm gonna drink beer, and that's how I'm gonna get my my boobs, you know. And now women, like, basically strip everything away and then go, and then the bosom with, like,
a fake fake boob. And I don't think that works. I don't like that.
That is a look.
It's deep.
You're right.
They strip everything away, smoke, and then add the boob on top. That doesn't look good. What happened to the mentality of the former mentality of women to go the correct route of, I can't believe I'm talking about this with a woman, but of getting...
No, I like your vision. I like this.
Yeah, boobs the real way.
Well, so how would you get boobs the way how do you think about that as a guy? What would be getting boobs the real way?
Okay, so...
Go ahead.
Okay.
I want to hear what you have to say.
Okay, so boobs the real way, in my opinion, is like, okay, so, like, you get them naturally. Like, yeah, you eat, like, you drink milkshakes, you eat bad, like the way women in Chicago are built. Like, not fat, but, like, the bosom comes naturally, so, like, they're...
Yeah.
They got natural cannons, but if they lose weight, they're going to lose the bosom as well, so you kind of don't want them to lose weight, you know? If you tell your wife to lose weight if you're living in Chicago, then you're going to lose the bosom, so you're kind of in a lose-lose situation. If you tell her to lose weight, you're going to get slapped, and then you're going to lose the bosom as well. But
yeah.
If...
Would you rather have a little bit of bosom and a little bit of weight, or someone that's a little bit more fit and no boobs?
See, I don't think you can lose either way. I think it's a win-win either way. You know what I mean? Like, it's kind of it's a catch-21, or a catch-22, you know?
Yeah, no, I do know.
Unless you're getting a boob, I mean, like, and if you got a boob job, you're...
Body by Becky, God, this is... If you wouldn't look... I mean... Yeah, okay, it would be great. It'd be awesome to have huge knockers, but... I mean, you look perfect as you are. Because...
Thank you.
I mean, your body fits... Your body is,
proportioned.
Right. But if... I mean,
yeah.
But if you... add the bosom, and then, but if you gained weight the natural way of, like, eating horrible food for you, and then you gained the bosom, see, it would look right, but if you're the average LA woman, which you're not, you would just add the bosom on top of this, and then it wouldn't look right, if that makes any sense.
No, it does make sense, and I think that as long as a girl has enough to, when she wants to flaunt it, be able to flaunt it, then that's enough. Like, if I want to go out and have, like, boobs out, I have enough to make it look like I've got... Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I don't have that want to, like, have huge boobs, because if I want, I'll just go wear a bra and wear an outfit and then also my boobs tonight. Like, you know? Does that make sense to you? And I think I'm very proportioned. My sizes are, like, my hips and my chest are the same size.
Yeah.
Makes sense. I think that I was made to be, like, this is my size.
Wait.
I don't know.
You had a body sculpted by the gods themselves. Is that what you're saying?
Now that I think about it, because when I first had my measurements done, and they were like, wow, you hit, they're like, oh, is that good? They were like, but the thing that I think about, I wouldn't want my boobs bigger than my hips.
Ah.
And I think that's what you were saying about, like, super skinny and then just boobs on top. Because that is out here.
Well, that's true. I mean, it's almost like putting two, like, it's almost like when you ask for, like, a chocolate sundae or something at a restaurant, and they put, like, I don't know, caramel topping on top of what's already there. It's just, like, almost unnecessary. So, like, if you went and got...
It was already good.
Yeah.
It was already perfect.
Right.
Yeah.
If you went out and got a boob job, now, it would just be like, okay, well, I mean, she's just adding. She's just basically saying to the world, "Screw you." I could go without this, but I'm going to go ahead and do this anyway because I can, and that's what I mean, it's just too much, you know?
Uh-huh. I do know. Sometimes too much is a good thing. It's too much. No, I do know. Sometimes the hot dog doesn't need to be that long. That was too long of a hot dog. That's doctor.
Wait, are you talking about real hot dogs, or are you talking about guy's hot dogs?
Anything in life. And sometimes it's too long or too big or there's too much. Yeah. And sometimes too much of something that's really good is too much. Sometimes you don't be careful for us.
Oh my god. This is good stuff. But well, what about you're a fit chick, you're a good looking chick. Are you going for the opposite with a guy? Are you looking for a guy that's doesn't give a crap, or are you gonna go the guy from The Incredible Hulk, Lou Ferrigno? Lou Ferrigno, is that the route you're going?
I don't know. That might be my problem. I'm still single. I know what I don't like with guys. So I think that there's just this magical balance, and I'm not sure about it. I'll tell you this, in all of LA and all of the world, if you spend more time getting ready than I do, and if your jeans cost more than my jeans cost, and I'm aware of that because you told me, then that's not attractive.
Wait.
And I can't help drink you when we go out. That's probably not a good thing either. I actually really don't mind, and I think that that's a super huge assumption from a lot of people, that if you're not totally into fitness or not totally fit, I would date someone that isn't just like me in that area. Because I think that some differences are good, and I can appreciate that balance, that they probably are a little bit balanced or a little bit more chill. Because, you know, I'm pretty high strung. If somebody has the ability to chill me out a little bit, I appreciate that more. I don't expect them to. There's very few people that have been in my life that would want to work out as much as I do, and I realize that. And so it's a good balance, I think.
Well,
so, as far as guys, I don't know the answer to that.
What if a guy, first of all, a guy was saying to you that he wore designer jeans?
It's terrible out here. Yeah. Yes.
Oh my god.
I mean, you know, because they're so, and also out here, because a lot of guys are into acting,
God.
I can tell if you pick, what happened 2 Fridays ago is that Leo said, Dr. Game, he tried way too hard. I'm like, how do you have this much time? And then, you know, he put on the music. The first thing that came out of my mouth was, you totally made this CD for right now. He did, because it was Van Morrison. How do you know how to play Van Morrison on the first night you pick up a girl?
Right.
Unless you Google it from some blog that said the perfect mix CD for the first date. I just had to address it because I'd rather have a guy that's going to listen to whatever music he'd rather want to listen to instead of what people told him that they would like for him to listen to on the first date.
So if a guy picks you up and he's listening to Highway to Hell by AC/DC, you're saying that?
Yeah, that's him. Do it. Yeah. I don't care. That's cool. I love all music, but listen to the music you listen to. Don't make him. I don't know. Sometimes it's good to show effort, because I know some guys don't think that it's good to be kind and give little cute things that girls say that they don't need, but every girl really likes. But then there's also I want someone that's just confident enough on also to just be themselves. Even if that's eating or drinking whatever, or no, Becky, I don't want to work out. You're crazy. You work out too much. I'm going to chill today.
Yeah.
People that are just honest with what they do or do not do. And that's why I said to you earlier, I think I was expect how you just do things. Like, I don't know. That's good quality.
What, how I just don't give a crap?
What I have learned is that a lot of times, there's the fake aspect of, like, what you said, like, plastic surgery, here's a lot more, you know, there's a lot more bigger boobs. But the fakeness is not plastic surgery-wise. People can lose themselves out here because they just try to follow the trends or to be so into it. And I'd rather someone just be more, like, be able to like ACDC because, no, I turn that on and I like it. That would be all that I would want. It's just, if you like ACDC, just listen to it. That'd be great.
Well,
that makes sense.
Well, oh, yeah, it makes total sense. I completely understand where you're coming from. Like, you,
okay, good.
Well, you don't want the, I mean, how do I want to put this delicately. Like, it's almost like the women in L.A. or, I guess, people in L.A. and, I mean, basically, the entire world have gotten to this point where it's self-entitlement, and so that leads to kind of like, okay, well, I have to have huge jugs to be successful in Hollywood. I have to do this, or no, it's not I have to, it's I need this, I'm going to get it. And what happened to the mentality that we kind of have, where it's like, you know, okay, worry about, like...
Like, I bought a pair of jeans that are over $15-$20, and, like, what happened, like, guys are so caught up in trying to impress people with, and I don't know, like, I think the one time I really tried hard to date a chick, I mean, it blew up in my face because I just became a self-righteous douche by, you know, listening to Barry Manilow, trying to convince myself that that was good music, and, you know...
Like, we know... Exactly, we know you don't listen to Barry Manilow. Like, I know that that's not, like... I know you don't listen to Van Morrison because you... Like, I know that. You know what I mean? Like, it's so obvious.
Well, you don't...
Right, just to yourself.
You don't know that I don't take a bubble bath and listen to Barry Manilow by myself in the dark.
I'm sure you do, actually. I'm sure that's exactly what you do. And if you did that, I think it's awesome. You probably wouldn't put it as the first, like, debut song on your mixed CD when you picked me up. I doubt you would save it for the second date.
Well, that would be the deal. That would seal the deal, wouldn't it?
Yeah, that would be. Yeah, you wouldn't want to play your favorite hit right away. You wouldn't do it.
No.
You wouldn't.
Well, it's almost like a concert. I mean, you got, like, my thought on it is when I'm taking a girl out, I'm going to, you know, you got to kind of, it's almost like a concert. You don't want to pull out the best guns right away.
Maybe she's not deserving of them, and you need to save them, and just if it's good, and she's really feeling it, then you pull it out, but if not, then, exactly, yeah, exactly, I agree there, it is a concert.
I didn't think of it that way, the route of, you don't want to pull out the gun too fast. Like, you don't want to unload the gun too fast with the Barry Manilow. You want to kind of lead into the Barry Manilow. Like, slowly bring it in with...
Christine, Venture, Robert, Slash, Christine. Actually, I just solved it.
Good.
I just solved it with you. If you want to have a perfect day with Becky, you just go, like, throughout a Springsteen discology, essentially. And you eventually play that, like, one of the slow love Springsteen songs, you know?
Yeah, but I love Born in the USA, because I love America. If I hear Springsteen at all, you better make sure that Born on the USA is on there somewhere.
That is my second favorite Springsteen song. My first one's Murder Incorporated.
Oh my. I don't even know if I know that one. I'm going to have to download it.
You will
watch that poison YouTube video. I have so many things to do.
I know. You have to listen to my show first. You have to...
Which I'm going to do first. Wait, Murder Incorporated?
Yeah, here. Here, I'll tweet it. Huh. Here, I'll tweet it over to you really quick. This is going to be some great.
Awesome.
This is going to be some great radio for people listening to me tweet over to you. Murder Incorporated by Bruce Springsteen.
Yeah, I like it.
And actually, you're going to find out if you listen to the whole song, you're going to figure out why it's my favorite song.
I really actually like it a lot.
You will like.
I feel like it a lot.
Okay, hold on. I just spelled murder improperly.
That can happen.
Yeah.
That can happen at one.
Well, are you, how do you, pawn off the stupid or the dumb blonde notion? Is that
should
tough?
I really reveal my secret?
Yes.
So, we did this phase in my life, which was like last year, growing up, to be honest. My dad is so smart, he has a PhD in something I don't even know about, but now I know it's, in public policy and something, because I've learned about it, instead of saying, I don't know what it's about. But growing up, I was great in sports, and if you have a personality, and you're just genuine, and you're a hard worker, you don't really need to be that good in class. So, I got grades and that kind of thing. I got good grades. But my dad would always say, Becky's not so great in books, that's her weakness. So, this last year, I think also in your 20s, you try to find yourself.
Yeah.
I was like, I'm going to be freaking smart. So I started reading books that weren't maybe my favorite book. And then I started learning to do all these different things. And I tried really hard to be the blonde that was, also smart. And it was a lot of work. But then I realized... One day, and it's this epiphany, it might have been one of my brunette girlfriends, too, was that's just part of you. We don't think you're, really dumb all the time. You're definitely not ditzy and just have nothing to you, but that's the part of you that, can't spell or formulate full sentences. And so, 4 to 5 months ago, I just, now I am a little bit, because I started reading and that kind of thing. I just embrace it, but... With that said, there are some times and situations that I don't want to say what I want to say.
Nope.
I use it to my advantage because I think I'm smarter than some people think that I am. And not so much book smart. But when I say book smart, street smart, sense-wise, I have to have common sense if I moved out here and doing all the things I'm doing. But if I'm in a situation where I need to be the dumb blonde, I'll be the dumb blonde to figure out and get what I want out of whatever I need,
You would do it too. Well, I can't. I'm not blonde.
But, there's some situations where it's just better to play that card if somebody's gonna... If somebody's gonna tag that on you anyways, it's better to just go with it.
Well, I mean... You can, I would give you this. I'll give you this. It's better than adding the fake bosom. You're going the right route. You're going the route of playing something that's legitimate. Being a dumb blonde or acting as a dumb blonde is different than, throwing on add on the fake boobs and then, that just, actually that would play in well for you, I guess.
Well, no, so here's the thing is, if you're going to tag me with that, a lot of times guys will do that or sometimes girls, I'll do it and then just to, because in that way it's I'm being smarter in the situation. So I use it a lot. It works to my benefit because, especially with work, I've been in a lot of situations with deals and things that I've had to finalize. And if you're in a room with people that think they're all smarter than you, it's sometimes more beneficial to let them continue to think that, especially when you're, like, signing a deal. Because then when it comes down to paperwork or money, that kind of thing, you know that you're really not that dumb. Like, I don't know if that makes sense or not.
Like, basically, you're...
Don't reveal my secrets!
Don't worry, nobody listens to this show anyway.
Oh, God. I do. I'm the biggest listener. I love the Bob Sullivan show. It's my favorite show.
Well, you're the first ever female to say that. It's okay.
So reading's fun. I realize that sometimes I read books. Mm-hmm. I'll be honest, I read what I want to read and not sometimes what's in the book. Even if it's like, you know, a great classic masterpiece, like the Iliad. I'll read it in what I want to read, and then I tell my dad about it, because I want to have a smart conversation with my dad, and then he actually informs me that what I read was not at all what I read. So, I will say, I did put forth in this last year, though, a strong effort of making up for all the classes and things that I just kind of got A's in that maybe I shouldn't have. So, I mean, I put forth the effort, I read.
So you're saying you use your looks to your advantage when to get a better grade?
Yes, and also my personality, and also I would always sit. I'm very involved, so I would sit up front or like pay attention. You know, well, even if I didn't know what was happening.
Since you knew, well, I mean, if you're sitting up front, who's not going to see that lovely smile?
Right. And then, exactly. And then, look, if you just look, like, and then if the teacher would ask a question and you give the I'm thinking face, don't call on me, but I'm sitting up trying to pay attention, they won't call on you.
Oh, wow. You know, yeah, I've noticed that, too. Like, I try to, when I was, you know, I'm not the brightest crayon in the box, not by any means. I can read, but just because you can read a book, I don't think that proves anything. I'm not saying that because you can read a book. I'm saying in general. I'm capable of reading the book, I'm just too lazy to do it. So I'm more of a visual learner. So like if TV is great. It is one of the greatest things ever created because I learned so well from like just like different sports and stuff. You know, like I mean, I'd argue that you learn more from more life lessons from playing sports and watching sports than you do actually in school. School doesn't teach you jack shit, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Like, how many times did you, since you've been out of school, where you've been like, I learned that in school instead of, I learned that after school, no thanks to Miss whoever who was teaching that class.
A lot of times I go, I wish I was taught that. When I learn it now, mm-hmm. Yeah, now I don't ever have an aha moment of like, I'm so thankful for the teacher. She really taught me that. No.
It is a crime that teachers get as much credit as they do for, you know, you went to college, didn't you?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Where did you go?
I went to Charleston in, look at me talking out loud. I went to Charleston in Baltimore, just north of the city. My undergrad is in kinesiology, exercise science. And I mean, I picked that major because it had the word exercise in it, and my first semester was freaking physics and biomechanics. I was like, this is hard. And they're like, it's exercise science, Becky. There's a science to it. And I was like, gosh, this is hard. So,
well, it's, I mean, I went to college for, what was it? 1 year,
and I didn't get welcomed back. But my view on school is that it would be really hard for me to, the people that eventually become teachers, like from your classes and stuff, it's like, how the hell are they teachers? Like, you see them behind the scenes, and they're still acting the same way teaching school children that they were in college, and you're like, what? How is this work? Like, how are they allowed to teach children? Like, I see it every day, and it's like,
I recently had that experience. I know what you mean. Then there's some teachers, like my sister teaches second grade and at a school in Baltimore and all dyslexic kids, and she's so passionate about what she does. But it's like very, I see her and I think it's brilliant what she does. But then I also, very recently, what you're saying situationally, like I know the individual and how she really is, and then now she's doing all this teaching with kids, and I think in my mind, like, hush, exactly what you just said, and it made me worry, too, because if she's what's teaching our children of tomorrow, and they know all the things going on with her, like, oh my god, what's going to happen to those kids that she's in charge of? Yeah.
Right.
I understand what you're saying. I do. Yeah. It's really hard to find good teachers, and it's a shame. I do. I think that
you must have a great relationship with your sister then, if you're concerned about what she's teaching our youth.
Well, I'm confident. My mom, I'm very close with all my siblings, not especially that sister. This situation I'm talking about is a friend. She's a friend, but it's like I know her so personally, and it's like, an acquaintance friend, and then now I know after that I start to know a lot about her, what she does, and she teaches little kids, and I was like, oh my gosh, she teaches little kids. That's crazy. Like, I don't think that's safe. Like,
no.
Someone needs to monitor her with those children. Like, I really thought that. That's terrible. And especially, I don't know if you heard, I can't even say it, but what can teach you up here have done recently?
The sex?
They were so messed up.
With the sex with the students?
These other teachers made these cookies.
Oh.
These guys, I can't even say what they put in the cookie, and they made all the kids eat them.
What did they put in the cookie?
They made crumb cookies, and they made all the kids eat them. This is on national, this is on news out here, so I'm not just making this up.
What?
Like, they actually did that.
Oh my, jeez.
Can you imagine?
That's not even something you do to, somebody you go on a date with. That's messed up.
Whoa, did you ever see Van Wilder?
Yeah.
That was what I could think of. When they messed, and they couldn't vocalize it because I couldn't remember the movie it was from. But I was like, they got that from Van Wilder. That's so messed up.
Well,
and there's some little kids. And then Bill Wilder wasn't as bad because they did it to the dad, mean fat guy. But this, they did to harmless little children.
Well, how did they, where do you come up with an idea? Like, first of all, how does that idea cross your mind to do that to kids? And second of all, how does that get found out that happened?
I'm not sure. Because for some reason they were obviously doing it for some reason. I can't imagine some guy just doing that and not telling his friends about it or not. That would be even more disturbing if someone's just doing that regularly for fun and telling no one but himself. People that were doing it together, and then somehow somebody said something and I forget how it got told out, but it was on the news. Somebody had documented it in some form of hard footage, whether it's video or wrote about it so that there's some sort of evidence, and then someone got onto it and then finally told.
You know, my question, this is going to sound kind of grotesque, but my question with, all these teachers having sex with, their students, these hot chicks that are teachers now, where were these men when I was in school? I had,
Like, I know, I get it, I know. Isn't it crazy? I hate that too. Like, I've never once had a guy or a girl teacher that I ever was like, damn, I can't wait to go to so-and-so's class.
Yeah.
That never happened. I can't wait to watch her write on the chalkboard. Like, no, I never saw it like that. I had no teachers like that, ever.
No, there was never.
Ever.
Like, I had not nuns, but I had, like old ladies teaching me that were, like, 70 years old. And, like.
Where you're from. Where were you from? Where were you born and raised?
I was born and raised in Omaha, Nebraska.
Yeah.
Well, that.
Well, I want to think, like, my small town where I was born and raised is the same. Like, teachers just. You don't have that there. I don't know why. But maybe not. I don't know.
Well, like, how many, like, would you ever, like, I mean, how would you react? Like, I mean, I know I would never have to deal with, like, okay, here, this one I'm going to share with you, like, because I'm not really afraid to talk about it, but I was a coach for, I was coaching high school baseball last summer and last spring, and so I'm only 22 right now. And there's
no way.
You're
only 22?
Yes.
I have no idea. Are you like a little baby?
I am a little baby. I mean.
Oh, and you're like age 22. I'm not that much older than you, but I always think that some people are my age or younger or older. You've lost. Or gain 60 pounds, like, I never can say I've done that in a lifetime. I've already done it by age 22.
I've almost lived, like, Ricky Lake's life in, like, the last, you know, year and a half. I've gained a lot of weight. Yeah. I have my own talk show.
And the people that you also reference as far as music and genre, is you have a depth in your, of your knowledge, of even just music. And I think sometimes music, when people start talking about music or their knowledge of it, it reveals an age.
Yeah.
And yours is, which is good. It's a good quality. Okay, sorry. 22.
Well, 22. Hey, I don't have a problem with you marinating me with your compliments. Not at all. But,
okay, so you were coaching and you were 22.
Okay.
Or you're 20.
I would have been 21.
Okay, that's right. 25. Yeah, you could drink and go to practice and coach. That's good. Just kidding.
I could, but I did not do that. Actually, I do have a story about that as well, but that'll have to be for off the air. But, okay, so I didn't do the math. Like, there was a girl, like, I was coaching at the same high school that I played at. And so I came back to coach. Well, there's was a girl that went to the high school that I didn't do the math. Like, okay, she's a senior now. And she texted me one time, and I was like, like, just chatting back and forth thing. And the next day, I saw her at the school, and I was like, oh, hey, you're, what are you doing here? Are you coaching track? She's like, no, I run track. And at that point, I was like, okay. And I deleted the number from my phone, and I was like, okay. Like, if that's my reaction, and I'm, like, I'll admit I'm, like, kind of a pervert, but I'm not going to have sex with a high school student while I'm coaching a team or a high school student in general. But, I mean, if that's my mindset to delete the number immediately, like, how far does your mind have to be gone to either continue that or to jerk off into a cookie and sell it to sixth graders?
I know, and I don't know. And that's the thing that's like, because that's what you just said, that would be my reaction too, and I'm not sure if that's the influence of our upbringing, if that's the influence of, you know, just our experience, or maybe playing a sports team, or maybe being in high school. I don't know if it's high school. I'm not sure, actually, how someone gets to be like that, or how maybe they had a really bad experience somewhere, something traumatic happened to them. Maybe their goal as, you have no idea, but I have no idea, but my, like, the reaction I just had when you found out she ran track would have been my same reaction. You just can't do that.
No. No. God. And if I continued texting her or whatever, I'm thinking, like, yeah, okay, like, yeah, she's pretty hot, but, I mean, and yeah, she's 18 and everything, but bottom line, it's a coach and a high school student. I mean, any way you slice it or dice it, it looks bad. And me...
Yep.
Go ahead.
No, you see it like that. Some people just don't see it like that, I've realized. And I guess I always thought things like that, like, you know, how you... But, you know, everyone could have the same reaction, like, oh my goodness, some people don't see it like that.
Well, how would you react if you were teaching yoga to some portly 16-year-old fat kid, and he then asks, like, starts texting you randomly and saying, like, oh, Becky, you're so beautiful, and blah, 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 and really, really landed on you. And what do you say? What do you, like, are you like, sorry, Tommy, I'm going to have to delete your number and you're no longer welcome to my class. What do you do?
I've gotten really good at, limiting, like, he wouldn't have, I would give him my email or something that I could, I've gotten really good at creating this natural, like, lane of getting through to me, you know, like, by means of contact,
right,
without really realizing that I've done that. So, like, none of my students, regardless of age, have my cell phone number. They could call the front desk if they needed me, like, at wherever I teach at the studio. They have, you know, and follow my social media stuff. Like, I would never let him, but I've gotten messages through that. I'll ignore and act like I didn't get them. And I don't know if that's the right thing. But, if you wrote it in the email, oh my gosh, now you're coming up with a situation that happened at work. And then I would just probably have that email and forward it maybe to a manager and just say, I'm not sure what to do with this situation. Please advise. So then that's like done. I play football on Sundays with high school, Blue Lake in Southern California. Right. And they're high school boys, any age from 14 to the oldest. I mean, there's a couple guys that are in college now. But there's 14-year-olds out there on the field with me playing for real football. And that's the first time that I realized I'm in a situation, and I'm just playing to get my game better.
Mm-hmm.
So I figure, you know, you play with boys and you learn. But again, they all know I play for, like, the Laundry Football League, and they're like, without saying it, they all are so excited I'm at practice, although I'm serious. That was the first time this Sunday I thought, I realized the coach walks me to my car, and he's cool, but I realized some of the guys, they're 14, and I'm like, and it's not even that, you know, they're high school, I'm not even a coach or anything, where we play with their team. I'm like, I can definitely feel a situation that I would have to be like, honey, you're 14, like, just telling them what's up. That's totally different than being a coach or a player,
How many times would a guy, if he's, I don't know, okay, so, like, I can't even play. Like, I've gotten in, like, you play intramural sports, I assume, when you were in college, right?
Uh-huh.
So you know the rule, like, the rule you can't block a girl's shot in basketball? Like, in intramural, like, if you're a guy, you're not supposed to block a girl's shot. It's like an unwritten rule.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Okay, well, maybe it was the small, crappy college I went to. That was the rule.
No, but, like, go ahead. So, like, there's different rules on girls than guys?
Mm-hmm.
Huh.
Well, it was a small, crappy college. So, the way I played, I play the game no easy buckets. So, I mean, you come into my lane, you're not, I mean, it's not going to be a walk in the park. You mean if you come in that lane, you have to be prepared to get blocked. Well, I had that mindset cuz I watched 90s NBA basketball and yeah. I got looked down upon. I got frowned upon by the men and the women in that league because I blocked three shots in a row, and I, not to mention, I did taunt after a couple of them because
sorry, that's funny.
Well, I had to. I mean, I blocked a shot. I'm a slow, fat white guy that, well, I wasn't fat at that time either, but I was a slow white guy that could barely jump. I mean, what's a guy supposed to do after a block? Am I supposed
to? Yeah, you're excited. That's just high adrenaline rush. Like, yeah.
So I got frowned upon for blocking a woman's shot. And, you know, I kind of find it to be, you know, what happened to, I think it's kind of a double standard, because aren't we supposed to treat women the same as men? What's your stand on that?
No, so, I'm really weird with that. I love Marilyn Monroe, and she had some quote. I forget what it was. That's a great story. But basically it was, women can live in a men's world as long to acknowledge, I'll have to find the quote, but women can live in a men's world as long as they know that they're not men. Her whole concept is so true. Like, I know I play football with these guys on Sunday, but sometimes I take myself out of a drill and I just go, you know, like, I'm not going to play this because there's no way it's fair. I don't want to be that the last kid at recess that someone has to have the girl on this side because she wants to play. I think where there's a strong difference about things, and if girls are going to put themselves in the same playing field as a male, they need to play and be prepared to play at that level. And, like, also, I cannot stand when women add, like, titles to things. Like, and I know I'm a female, and I get it. Okay, so I play sport right now, and if it's a lineman, it's a lineman's position. Like, it's not a line woman. Like, stop saying line woman. Like, I cannot stand that for some reason. And maybe it's because I grew up watching football, and I love. Like, but in no way, if you're playing basketball or something, any other sport, you don't have to say a woman. It's a man. It's just a man. Like, that's just the position. It's just because we're calling it a man be man. It's not woman, woman. Like, it's a man. It's a one man. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They think that this whole, like, feminist, sometimes they take it too far. Like, I know that they want equal rights with a lot of things, and that I appreciate that, and I know that some things we're just not going to be equals. We're not. I'm never going to run as fast as a guy. I'm never going to jump as fast as a guy. I'm never going to do those things. Like,
you
guys and just aren't. I didn't know that. Guys are stronger. Yeah, guys are made to be stronger. That's why they're. That's also the other thing, too. Like, even going back to dating, if I'm dating someone, you need to be a man. Like, that's whether it's just you have to. I like that there's men. There needs to be men, and I don't want to be on the same playing field with them. Like, for practice, that kind of thing, but not in life, not in, like, a conference room. It's just, there's just different things. We're females, we need to be treated like women. No, I don't care if you block my shot. I'm coming at you like I'm supposed to, and you're kind of just, that's your innate, what you were taught to do, and that's your reaction. It's also hard to unteach that. If you play basketball your whole life, and that's the pattern that you have when you're playing defense, you're not looking at her ponytail. She has a ponytail, or if it's a guy, you're just trying to block her shot.
Well, yeah, I was definitely frowned upon, and I was looked at like I was some kind, I was looked at like I was Bill O'Reilly or something that talks down to women. I don't talk down to women. I mean.
No, you don't. You're very respectful.
Wow.
But if I get talked down to by guys too, I don't get, and this is just my mentality, it's something going on with them. There's no reason that anyone needs to talk down to anybody, regardless of race, ethnicity, sex, and stuff. Whether it's a guy or a girl, anyone talking down to me, I don't get it. I mean, it's just like, what is I think in my mind, what is wrong? What happened to them today? Like, it's not, like, if he's going to talk, Bill O'Reilly's going to talk like that, I just think it's something going on that he's trying to prove something on his end. How's this one fucked up to me? I don't know.
Well,
I just felt so weird. Defense mechanism. I don't know how that's working out for me.
Well, I think it works out pretty well. I mean, you don't really need a defense for. I mean, I think you got it down pat how you're handling life. I mean, just kind of head in the not. This is gonna sound bad, but like head in the clouds and not really. You got to have the I don't give a fuck attitude, which I mean.
Yeah.
And I mean that's. I mean, I think that kind of makes you. A lot. I mean, that makes you kind of a catch, you know? The I don't give a fuck attitude. And, you know, it's just weird thing. Like, everybody thinks, like, okay, like, if I go to a bar and there's some hot chick or something across the bar, like, am I going to go talk to him? Probably not, because the Knicks game's on. But how many people are going to go talk to him? Because they think that they're so, like, what would you say the odds are of a guy walking up to you at a bar and the odds of a guy not walking up to the bar because he's intimidating? Like, what's the ratio on that for you, would you say?
Guys always feel like they can, they might be out here too, I realize, too.
Oh. Forgot you were in LA.
But the reason why they do it, why do they do it? So, like, if I go out, I'll be approached by someone about just, like, a question, or, so I will also learn, so for a little while, actually, it made me, because sometimes I just want to go out and watch the game, like you said, or, every time a girl goes out, she, or every time a person goes out, you know, sometimes it's not, she's like, I'm going to get somebody's number, like, I'm going to find some booty. Like, sometimes you just want to go out and hang out with friends and stuff. So, I realized that whether you're sitting at a table or a bar, like, different sitting situations and that kind of thing, also kind of puts a protective, like, you want to be social, you'll probably sit more at the bar, more around the crowd if you want to talk to people. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
People love to talk. Out here, people love to come up to you. Everybody thinks that they have something to say. Sometimes, my little sister is out here and she visited me recently. And she's younger, so protective. Like, just random people coming up and talking to her. And I found myself being like, excuse me, you're interrupting us. Like, because it's just like my little sister and like, you're way too old for her. Like,
yeah.
And I found myself being a little ruder than I am when you approach me. Because
that is
being protective, I think.
Not
sure.
Wow. I did not realize we have had a, like, two-hour conversation.
Can I say one thing? I think this is important. I know, it's been long.
No.
There's a gym etiquette.
This is not...
Guys.
Okay, that was not a bad thing, by the way. I'm not saying...
Huh?
I'm not saying wrap it up. No. I'm saying, like... Okay, go ahead, sorry.
But there's a gym etiquette that I think all guys need to know about. If a female, no matter how hot she is working out and has earbuds in her ears, don't come up and talk to her for 10 minutes. Like, especially the other thing is, like, if I'm on a piece of cardio equipment and this has happened and I'm on it and it's like, you know, if you're at these 30 minutes of cardio and you pick the elliptical or that treadmill,
right.
Don't you dare come and try to have a conversation with me while I'm doing, because that's like my, I love that time of like clearing my mind and like doing cardio, just like listening to my music, theme song is on, and that person comes, you're on that machine, like, I can't move, I can't leave that conversation.
Yeah.
It is a duplicate. So that's important that people realize there's that etiquette that you just respect is that earbuds are in. Don't talk. You just wait until her earbuds are out or that she's not on a sedentary piece of equipment. She cannot move. You know, it's just a few things. Don't you agree? Don't you agree, Bob?
Well, I don't go to the gym, so I'm not sure. But let me clarify this. If
you know, there's a time and a place when you can tell, like the girl has the fuck off written on her forehead, you know, like you, I'm not saying you have that. I'm saying, like, you're in a situation where, okay, you're in the zone. You're pumping some iron. You're hitting the speed bag. You're doing whatever. You're not gonna, yeah, you don't want to have a conversation about what you're doing later in that moment.
Not in that moment. Like, wait until, right, because a lot of times, even if I am having a series where I'm very rarely will I just, like, look like a bitch. I just smile. So, even if I'm, like, working out and I don't look like I have that face on, just respect my bubble for just when I'm finishing up that workout just for that time. You know, and like you said, you're not a gym suit. But I think that some people just need to read that a little bit. And I think that you would probably have read it because you just understand. Like, you're in the middle of doing something, you have dumbbells over your head and earbuds in your ears. Well, try to go have a conversation with that girl. Where you been? Not a good time.
Well, how many, like, would you rather be, like, if you have your earbuds in? Okay. What would piss you off more? Some guy walks up to you while you have your earbuds in and snaps your bra strap.
It hurts. Does that hurt?
Well, I don't know. I don't know if that hurts, but I assume it would.
It does hurt.
And, okay, so that's A. You have your earbuds in and you unknowingly get bra snapped, and or option B is you are in the middle of a workout and you're feeling you're into it, you're pumping the iron and whatnot, and then some guy taps you on the shoulder and says, "Hey baby, what's up?" What? Which?
Nobody would say, "Hey baby, what's up?" Actually, you should say that next time you pick up a girl, because I would laugh just like that. That line is like only for movies. That's a good for you. I'll answer that question. Freeze of lines always get me because they're like, wit. So if you went up literally to a girl and was like, "Hey baby, what's up?"
Mm-hmm.
I would just die laughing. That'd be awesome.
Well, what if?
What is my option?
Yeah.
If you touch me and I don't know you, I don't like that. And if someone I knew and did that to my real strap, it would probably be funny. So. And then they probably wouldn't have a conversation with me. They'd just let it be. Like, that's how they would say hi.
That's interesting.
What? What's that?
What, snapping the bra strap and then walk away because you know the person?
Well, it actually happens to me, which is weird. Yeah, because it's like, I end up, you know, the guy that I know at the gym, they know me. So if they're going to say what's up, and they normally kind of know, like, what's her later. So they'd come up and do something probably pretty stupid like that. And then it hurts. That's why I'm like, God, it hurts. Because that probably happened like 2 days ago. Do not, which someone thought was funny, threw a ball at me. Like, you know, like, just to say what's up. But it was a 15 medicine ball, and it hit me in my hip bone, and it hurt so bad. But he was trying to be like little kid, like just throw a ball at the girl, not realizing you can't throw a 50-pound medicine ball at a girl's hip.
Right.
Yeah, that's... I became mad. I just for 2 minutes was like in the fetal position, like cry. Like, I was like, oh my God. Because just hit that spot that hurt.
Well, do you remember playing dodgeball back in grade school and stuff?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
There was these, we played this game called Dr. Dodgeball where it was just chaos in gym class where basically you just, I mean, I don't need to explain the game, but it was dodgeball basically on steroids. Well, my strategy was I would like do like storage, like I would store all the dodgeballs over on one side, and then at some point I'd do this kamikaze attack and just take like 6 dodgeballs and just go throw them randomly at people and try to hit them. Well,
yeah,
and
smart.
It was smart, but the dumb part of it is, yes, there was a dumb part to that thing, believe it or not. I accidentally every time I would do the kamikaze, I would hit somebody in the face, and it would always be a girl. Like, I would, like, just throw them at random, so, like, anybody in the vicinity was going to get hit. And sometimes it would be a girl, and, like, you would smash a girl in the face with a dodgeball, and she'd start crying, and you'd be like, oh, shit. And at that point, like, that's, like, the worst feeling, is hitting a girl in the face with a dodgeball.
Yeah.
Because then you know there's...
Yeah, and in the face.
Yeah, and well, you know there's no chance of... I mean, there's no chance of a date after that, you know?
Maybe not. I mean, you might be wrong.
Well, I never got a date after that. That was bullshit.
You never asked because you're probably so scared to.
I was a little scared, but I was not.
Yeah, because you didn't hit the girl in the face. Like, you don't hit a girl in the face with the dodgeball when you're going crazy because of your strategic plan and you start railing a girl in the face.
Well,
you asked and talked to her, she probably would have laughed about it.
Well, that was my... That was my way of flirting, was to hit a girl in the face with a dodgeball.
I realize that sometimes that's the way that guys flirt.
Mm-hmm.
And I realize that no matter how old you get,
hurting a girl.
You're going to throw a ball in another girl's dodge, like, do that again in her face, because you guys do that even when you're growing up.
Hey, don't want me in.
I'm saying, I would respect that more than. Clean Van Morrison when you've never listened to his albums ever. You love to play it. I would respect that more.
Okay, a couple more things before I let you go. I think I'm gonna split this into like three shows, because this has just been great. But on a scale of
kind of why we're on here trying to find that Marilyn Monroe quote that I can't find.
The who?
She used to read her quote, Marilyn Monroe. I love her. So, which is weird, because that's the one I feel like don't love her. But, so I'm trying to find that one that I was seeing about, you know, how she, about men.
Oh.
She has this one quote that says, men are always ready to respect anything that bores them. So, you know, women are always like, I need to be respected.
Yeah, that's horrible.
Pretty good. I know. Again, listen.
Well, I'm not saying that women are horrible and I don't respect them. I'm just saying that it's horrible when they pull the I need to be respected card. That's worse than the race card.
Yeah, you're never going to get anything when you sit there and tell somebody anything. Like, you need to respect me, anything. Like, just don't, yeah, I agree. If a woman say that, or if a guy sat there, maybe.
Well, what